This is the way.
Yeah, mic check, 1, 2.
They see me rolling, they hating, patrolling, they trying to kiss me.
Rum and nerdy,
kiss me, 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 rum and nerdy.
Whenever I'm about to do something, I think, would an idiot do that? And if they would, I do not do that thing.
You want to play? I'll play. This is the way.
Ready to program! Let's go!
Hey everybody, and welcome to Rum and Nerdy. That's Garrick.
And that's Greg.
And today we have season 1, episode 2, the one about the eggnog.
That's the one about eggnog.
The one about. So this is the belated Christmas episode or holiday?
Yeah. We started filming this, started recording this weeks ago, and we're like, we'll have this released for Christmas, guaranteed.
Well, that didn't happen.
Not at all. Not even close.
You know, but it was some good stuff, and we want to teach you guys about the proper way to make eggnog. And our experimentation with different rums in that. And I think it actually turned out to be quite an interesting.
And let's be honest, you can really make eggnog on any time of your drink.
This is true.
I mean, it's not the kind of thing you want to reach for first after mowing the lawn in the middle of July, but still.
Well, and at the same time, if you drink this stuff year-round, you're going to have one hell of a cholesterol problem.
Why don't we try nogging other things, like a pineapple nog or a refreshing mint nog? You can only nog eggs?
I don't know. That just sounds broken.
Yes.
Anyway, so it's our Christmas special. I guess we can talk, like, how was your Christmas?
It was, would be, will be good.
This is a totally a Spaceballs bit. We're at now.
We're at now. Yeah. So in theory, we're recording it after we already did it. We started recording it before, but no one's listening to it during. So
I think my head hurts.
It was great.
It was.
You got your PlayStation in the 5 in the mail today?
I got it in the mail today. It is currently upstairs downloading previously installed games and.
Doing
Cyberpunk 2077.
Doing all of its PlayStation stuff.
Yes. It's a very intelligent machine. I think it's going to play itself later.
We should have Brian come back and do a review of Cyberpunk 2077. Because his first game center was about that game?
Yes. He started out about the most highly anticipated game of 2020. And
slash all time.
It has shit the bed. Although it's funny because on his account, him playing on a PlayStation 5, he has not had one glitch, one crash, nothing wrong with it whatsoever.
I heard that it was not necessarily developed for the PS5, but it's the only thing that runs it accurately.
Yeah.
Everything else just problems ensue.
It's funny because later in the year, in 2021, they're supposed to be releasing a PlayStation 5 patch or upgrade because they are still working on it being optimized for the PlayStation 5. Ironic that it's the one platform that it works on now.
Yeah. It's probably called the PlayStation 5 patch because they know everything else doesn't run it like the PlayStation 5 does. So
yeah. Well, I guess it's going to take even more advantage of the graphics and the speed processing and so on and so forth. So we'll see what happens, but that'll be interesting.
Hopefully the Grand Theft Auto people can learn a thing or two about it from it and roll it into 6.
Isn't it? I mean, that's the same company though.
No. Rockstar does Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah. This is CD Projekt Red.
Yeah. Their whole thing was just cyberpunk and, that was part of the issue with it being so ambitious and great, and it was like their only game.
Gotcha. Well, that's fun. So that was my main thing. I got a Blackstone griddle, used it for the first time last night, making salmon cakes, and I got to say, every single one of you guys have to go out and get one of these things. And this is, no, they're not sponsoring us, but holy crap, that's...
Is it just the gas-fired nature of the griddle?
It's, yes, it's the space. It's a similar finish and material as a black iron skillet. So yesterday afternoon, I had to heat it up and condition it, quote-unquote condition it, where you put oil on it and burn it back. And
AKA you burn off all of the...
The manufacturing.
All the manufacturing stuff, yeah. Yep.
So, you know, got it all. And it's one of those things that, you know, just like a black iron skillet, the more you cook on it, the more seasoned and
until one of your idiot friends puts it in the dishwasher.
Well, it's, yeah. The good thing about this is it won't fit in the dishwasher because it's a huge griddle. But it's great. It goes really well with the outdoor kitchen and everything. So
nice.
I'm excited about being able to do hibachi night. You know, and
I'm excited about you being able to do hibachi night. Yeah.
So we'll throw some shrimp on the Barbie and some lobster tails and some...
Nice.
I've got to do the little onion volcano like they do at Kobe. You know, and...
Choo-choo! Yeah. Ding, 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 ding. Yeah.
Because I got the big long spatulas like they have. So I got to learn how to toss the egg and
All that stuff. And then flip a shrimp into your guest's mouth.
Yep.
This is really hot. Catch it.
Yeah. Nice. Our insurance doesn't cover us having to do the Heimlich maneuver after this thing goes down your throat, but whatever.
I my big achievement for the holiday was I sous vide the Christmas roast.
Hmm. And how did that go?
Insanely well.
Really?
Insanely easy, too. I'm a huge fan of the sous vide.
Okay, so we're going to have to do this then where you do the... Because I am not a fan.
Really?
I'm not a fan of it. For me, it's just, it's part of coming from Kansas City. I think it's just, in my mind, it's like hey, look, we found a shortcut to making really good meat. And there, it's like, no, there is no shortcut to spending a lot of time and doing it.
If you're doing barbecue, you know, I can see that. But just, you know, the roast that you would usually put in the oven for X number of hours and, you know, you have to take it out and baste it and, you know, make sure you don't overcook it and sear the edges and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
The sous vide just takes care of all of that. And okay. And it turns out really well.
Okay. And we'll have to try it soon. Maybe we can do an episode on...
Ooh, the Rum and Nerdy cooking special.
There you go.
The one with the baking. It'll be the most exciting episode yet.
Well, baking is different. The one with the meat.
The one with the meat. Nah, yeah. That sounds wrong.
Okay. We'll see where it goes.
Cool. Well, hey, let's get into some freaking eggnog.
Awesome. Yeah. So let's hear from Central Florida Rum Council, and when we get back, we'll nog it up.
Go nog.
And now for a Central Florida Rum Council public service announcement. Rum, it might not solve all your problems, but neither will milk.
This program was pre-recorded. Well, of course it was pre-recorded. When else are you going to record it? Afterwards?
Welcome back from the break. Let's get into our first full holiday segment. This is going to be the eggnog segment of the holiday special.
Probably going to be my favorite segment of the holiday special.
You think?
I love eggnog.
Eh.
Eh?
We've got holiday movies to talk about. We've got stuff to do.
Oh, yeah, I know. I'm just saying. Eggnog.
Eggnog. Okay, so... a few weeks back, I reached out to Garrick and said, hey, have you ever made homemade eggnog? And he said, yeah, I do it all the time. And I said, I haven't done it since I was a child. I helped my father once many, 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 many years ago, but I always wanted to. So we did it. We got together. We made a batch.
Several.
We made a double batch, which was 6 32-ounce bottles. And then we decided that was not going to get us through the season. So we did it again. And mixed it up a little bit with the rum. So let's start off. We'll talk about the rums.
Yeah. Well, let's start off with the eggnog.
Okay. Yeah.
So we'll get all the nerdy recipe stuff out of the way.
So to start with, I had found a recipe I did a lot of research on what was the right recipe for mixing it with rum, something that was going to age really, really good over a few weeks, and settled on a recipe. You start off, we would, you know, because, you know, again, I'm going to try and keep it to where I'm telling you the right, because we doubled everything. We made a double.
We did make a double batch.
Yeah. So we started off, it was a dozen eggs and a couple half of sugar per batch. We doubled it. And a teaspoon of vanilla, 4 cups of whole milk, 5 whole cloves, mm-hmm. a half a teaspoon of cinnamon, and a teaspoon of, or a half a teaspoon, flip that, teaspoon of cinnamon, half a teaspoon of nutmeg, and then 4 cups, half and half. Later on, we would add in the rum, which we'll kind of come to later.
Well, yeah, but let's touch on the process real quick.
Yeah.
So if those people at home that would like to try making this, there is a bit of a wait. You're going to want it to age a little bit, so you're probably not going to have it ready by Christmas, but...
Eggnog can be consumed in mid-January.
Yeah. No, it'd be a great way to make it through the holiday lockdown.
There you go. This is how you would celebrate the end of the Christmas quarantine.
There you go. The Christmas quarantine nog.
Yeah. So when we start out, Garrick started separating the eggs. You want to only use the egg yolk. He separated the whites and took them home to make cookies with his wife.
Because cookies.
And so the you take a half a dozen, and again, we doubled it, egg yolks. We put them in the KitchenAid so they could start to whip. You slowly mix in a cup and a half of sugar.
You can mix it by hand, but admittedly, that's a pain.
Yeah.
So if you have a nice mixer, you can just let it sit there and...
Yeah, it does its thing.
Yeah.
Gets a nice whip. It whips everything. Froths it really, really well.
Whips it good.
Whip it good. And slowly add in a cup and a half of sugar. While that's happening, take the 4 cups of milk, put it in a saucepan. You want to bring it up to just a boil. With it in there, you're going to have the cinnamon, a teaspoon of vanilla, and the 5 cloves. You let that heat up. When it's done, while it's still hot, we strained it.
Got to get the cloves out.
Yep.
You don't want sticks and shit in your eggnog.
Yep. So we got all the big chunks in that out, so separated it out. And then in the KitchenAid, as it was whisking, we, about a cup at a time, slowly added in the warm whole milk mixture. Get that all mixed together, nice and smooth and consistent. Mm-hmm. You take all of that out, you put it back in the saucepan, and then you bring that up. You want it medium high heat, but only for 3 minutes.
Yeah, not a boil, real quick.
So the idea is that the heated milk and then this heat, what you're doing is you're tempering the eggs so that you're not eating raw eggs, because that's a bad thing.
Yeah, apparently.
So so that mixture, you get it, you put it back in a pan, put a lid on it, and then you need to chill it. So we put it into the refrigerator.
1 hour later.
Once you have the mixture chilled, then you want to slowly mix in the 4 cups of half and half. Mm-hmm. Really, the recipe calls for light cream. You just have a hell of a time finding it in grocery stores.
Yeah.
And half and half is pretty close. So you take that, mix in the half and half. You'll add another teaspoon of vanilla, half teaspoon of nutmeg, and then 2.5 cups of your rum. And this is where it gets to our favorite part.
It's really the most important part of the entire process.
Yeah. So when we were doing it, we went 2 different directions. The first one is we used Black Anchor rum, which is a really good rum. It's one that in the past we'd realized that if you mix it with root beer with a little bit of rum chata, it tastes kind of like a rum butter beer.
That's delicious.
It's so good. Very, very sweet. You're going to get diabetes. Mm-hmm. And I could make that joke because I have diabetes.
So it the Black Anchor, you know, the spiced rums, you're leaning on the flavor of the rum to become part of the eggnog.
Yes.
Versus the way I've traditionally made it with overproofed rum is you go in with something that, you know, really has the flavor palette of gasoline, but you're relying on your eggnog recipe to balance it out. You know, so that's really where the aging part comes into play.
So with that in mind, we actually did two different versions of that overproof. Mm-hmm. We started with your 151. When we did a second batch, we again doubled it, made half of it with the Black Anchor, mm-hmm. and we did the other with the Plantation OTFD.
OFTD.
OFTD. And so, which is also an overproof.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this one's the 60%. By volume. So it's
60 or 69%.
Oh, 69, sorry.
69, dudes!
And on that, the OFTD stands for Old Fashioned Traditional Dark. However, the makers of this, it was a group of people, rum makers that got together. And the rumor is that it was named after somebody sipping it for the first time and saying, oh, fuck, that's delicious. but they couldn't put that on the bottle. So they came up with another thing to make OFTD stand for.
Nice.
But the other, the 151 was?
Diamond Reserve. So that's, it's a clear rum, kind of a traditional overproof. Not spiced, not a lot of flavor, but we'll get to that in a second.
Okay. So, and was there a reason that you had done that before with that one?
Yeah, traditionally I'd use Bacardi 151, mm-hmm. which is conveniently not available anymore.
Okay.
Thanks, Bacardi. You got rid of the one rum of yours that we actually used. but yeah, so I was looking for a substitute for that. So we'll see how this one turns out.
Okay. So we mix all that up. We mm-hmm. Made labels for the bottles. We siphoned everything off. We bottled it all up, capped it up.
And we used reusable bottles. Yeah. In the past, we've taken old wine bottles with reusable corks and...
Or
screw cap bottles, but
yeah. So Rum and Nerdy has officially purchased 12 bottles, of which we have 11.
I'm pretty violent when I wash glass bottles, and when you have granite countertops, it's not always a good thing.
Yeah, mistakes were made. So we officially own 11 bottles that we have now bottled up. We used your Diamond 69 to replace that last bottle, so that we have 12 bottles of eggnog that are now aging. So now that all that stuff's done, you throw it in the refrigerator and you let it sit.
2 weeks later.
Now those bottles are ready to pull out of the refrigerator, pop that cork, and start enjoying. However, why don't we try the rums first so we can kind of get the sense of what we're going to be enjoying?
Yeah, I think we have a nice progression of rums here. I think we're going to start with the Black Anchor.
I like this rum.
This is really good. This was reviewed once before, but this is going to be a good one to try.
Very nice.
It's really sweet.
Yeah. Very smooth too.
This is a really great rum. I think to your point, this is either going to pair really well with the eggnog, or it's going to be destroyed by it. Hmm. I don't know.
Just tasting it by itself, I kind of get a bit of that eggnog. That it's that nutmeg, cinnamon, vanilla, those flavors that we put into the eggnog. We have them in this glass right now.
Yeah, that's why I don't know if it'll be. It'll be interesting to see if it becomes just lost in the mix. Or if it helps highlight the mix. I'll be really curious to see it.
I'm leaning towards highlight. I hope so, too, because we have 6 bottles of the stuff.
We may have made 2 batches of that one. Okay. So next, on the logical order of which to try these, we're moving up to the Plantation.
We're doing this in ascending alcohol content?
Yeah, but also flavor palette. Mm. Well...
We don't know that.
Not really flavor palate. I'm assuming after the 151, nothing is going to taste like anything anymore. So,
yeah, that just tastes like burning. Oh, nice sound effect. Fully that.
It's got a nice nose.
So this one I'm excited about trying because it does have that strength of an overproof. However, nicely done.
Thank you.
It has the strength of an overproof, but it's got the superior distilling of Plantation. Now, Plantation, who's known for a lot of really good fruity flavors in their rum. And you can get them even in overproof. In fact, on the nose, I don't get a lot of that.
I don't get any overproof.
Yeah. I definitely get kind of a nuttiness.
I bet you get a nuttiness.
Wow. That is the smoothest overproof I've ever had.
Agreed. It's definitely overproof.
Yeah. Yeah, you can feel it going down, but that it doesn't have that kind of burniness that you would expect from...
Yeah, there's no burny. It's...
Just warmth.
It's warm. There is a lot of warm.
Warm like eating a Hot Pocket right out of the microwave. No, it's not that.
I'm gonna throw some Coke in mine to wash out that glass.
Agreed.
That's delicious, though. I mean, I would not have expected an overproof to taste anywhere near this good. In fact, this is a good one to remember for the future if you're going to make a mixed drink where you need something with a little more punch, but you want it to be flavorful and not just taste like battery acid.
Yeah, definitely. We all, you know what? We should just circle back to this in the future and maybe we bring Tommy back in for a nice tiki recipe episode, and we throw this into one of them.
Oh, he's got to have a good recipe for Plantation.
Oh, yeah.
OFTD.
OFTD. Oh, that's fucking delicious. It is. It is. It is a really delicious, really strong rum.
I was not expecting it to be that good.
Yeah?
Because even when you would make it in the eggnog, and we were doing a double batch, so we had the Black Anchor batch immediately next to the OFTD batch. And just smelling them, you could tell which one was which.
Oh, yeah.
One pot burned the nose just a bit more than the other.
Well, let's do a little taste of this 151. And then before we pop open the eggnog, let's take a quick break.
Oh, that's a good plan. Okay, so the 151, as Greg mentioned before, I broke a bottle. So we use the 151 bottle for one of the Nog batches. So the rest of the 151 is in a squirt bottle.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
Whoops. And apparently it leaks a little bit.
Did you get the lid on there right?
Sure. Hope this doesn't bleach my shirt. That's overproof rum from a squirt bottle. Alrighty. Greg, you want to take that?
Yep. Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Woo! Definitely got some caramel in that.
Wow. What's really funny is that the burning, it's not up front. You first drink it, and your initial thought is, that's not that bad. I think I could drink a glass of, and then it rolls in and hits you like, oh, no, this is terrible. Oh, man.
Yeah.
Definitely, it kind of tastes like, some kind of medical sterilizer.
Yeah, definitely, for sure. Whew, on that one, I'm going to need to get a glass of water or something to water that down before it hits my liver. Let's take a quick break.
Yeah, let's cleanse the palate before the nog.
Awesome. We'll be right back.
I am Santa Claus. Ho, 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 ho. Yeah.
travels the world. Much, much, much later.
Okay, we're back to now.
Let's pop the cork on now.
Okay, so this has been allowed to sit for about 3 weeks.
Yeah, we got some good time on it.
I think this one's 3 weeks. I think that one's about 2 weeks. The OFTD.
Oh, first batch versus second batch?
Yeah, this was first batch. No, this is second batch. This is the second batch Black Anchor.
Okay.
So we're going to start with the Black Anchor. This is one of our you know, current favorite rums that is known for
it's known for us having reviewed it in the last
So it's good with root beer. That's a good one with root beer. We did it with root beer and rum chata, and it kind of sounded like, or it tasted like
butterbeer-ish
mm-hmm. rum drink. So we really liked it. I thought that it would go well with the eggnog flavor. So here we go. I don't know how much to pour.
It's a little, no, not even that much.
Okay.
It's a lot of nog to be nogged. That's good. Yeah.
Okay. So here we go.
Right off the bat, smells like eggnog. Oh,
so good. It's just so much sweeter, clean, smooth taste. I love it.
It tastes almost like regular eggnog.
What do you mean by regular eggnog?
I mean, you can barely tell that there's any rum in this at all.
Well, yeah, there's, 2.5 cups?
It's not bad. It's not a lot of rum proportionally, and it's not a strong rum. So, no. I mean, if somebody handed you a glass of this, you could almost drink it not knowing there's rum in it.
Yeah, and my opinion, like, when you really let the taste kind of linger in your mouth, you really get that butterscotch.
Mm-hmm.
Not just the caramel, but you really get like a really good butterscotch flavor.
Which complements the nutmeg and the cinnamon really well.
Mm. So good.
It is delicious.
Oh. Well, this bottle's empty now.
Okay.
And out of all the batches, this is it for me. I don't know. Did you go through all of yours?
Yeah, I got one or two bottles at home.
Yeah. Oh, that's a good sound effect. So this is the OFTD.
OFTD.
From the OFTD plantation. The glug, 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 glug.
This is the, what did we say it was? 66%?
69%.
Oh, yeah, that's right. There was a sound effect for that.
Yes, there was. You did a drip.
Yeah, it's a corporate laptop. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, but it's on my desk.
No. Yeah, worry about that.
So, on the nose, you definitely smell it's got alcohol in it.
Definitely. It's not bad, though.
No. Oh, this is really good as well. I get sweetness. Compared to the 151, which I don't have any more of.
I was going to lie about it and just remember what it tasted like.
Oh, yeah, well, we could do that, but just in comparison, because that was an overproof, this one's got a better flavor. That one was just
100%
strong. This one definitely
has a better flavor. This one has good taste. And again, when I've made this this recipe in the past, I've used a different 151
mm-hmm.
that I think had a better flavor palette with the eggnog, but this OTFD is good.
Oh, fuck, that's delicious.
Oh, that's fucking delicious.
I put the letters in the wrong spot on that.
Seriously?
It's OFT. Yeah, because the bottle's right up there.
Yeah. OFTD? Yeah, look at that. Yeah. Holy shit.
Oh, fuck, that's delicious.
Truthfully, this is my favorite of the batch.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
I
wouldn't mind experimenting with another 151, but I think if I were just to go make another batch of this, this is what I would use.
Yeah. So next year, we'll definitely do a batch of each of these.
Mm-hmm.
And over the year, we'll have to come up with another regular and another overproof. So we have two new ones and just kind of evolve.
And we should make them around Thanksgiving when you should actually make this stuff.
Yeah. So I'm going to put a little over half of an inch of this one in. I'm going to do a blended.
You're going to blend it?
To blend it. Well, to give me that that sweet smoothness and a little bit of that strength.
Will that make it a eggnog Solara?
It is certainly a blended rum.
That's good. That is good stuff.
Oh, fuck, that's Black Anchor. God, that's really good. Well, I think that actually might be better.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, here, give me a little bit of the Black Anchor.
And you got a drip going down that bottle on the backside.
Yeah. I'm out of cloth.
You've got plenty of time. That might be it right there.
That is really good.
Yeah. I think I'd change in my vote.
To do a mixed recipe?
Yep. I think the thing is to use a bottle of OFTD and a bottle of Black Anchor.
So it's 2.5 cups of rum?
Per batch.
Per batch.
We doubled the batch.
Double the batch.
So if you used 5 cups.
Yeah. In theory, you just blend it out. 2.5 for each. Yeah. 2.5 of each for each.
Yeah. And instead of separating it, because we make a double batch at a time, instead of separating it out, we just mix it all together.
That's a good plan. I like it. I like it.
Yeah, this is really, I think this is it. I think we just discovered the moment.
We're going to have to make new pop bottles for these now.
If only I had a vinyl cutter. We're probably going to end up taking at least the bottom down at the, because we talked that we're going to use the bottles, maybe like summer, doing something infused.
Hmm.
That would be fun.
Interchangeable labels. We need to work on that.
Yeah, we just make new labels. They're just, it's cheap vinyl. They'll pull right off.
Yeah. Cool. Alrighty. So this concludes the eggnog portion of the one with the eggnog.
Yeah, the one with the eggnog. Well, as mentioned before, too, is like we've got other things that we were going to do. We got to talk Christmas movies.
Oh, yeah. Well, let's talk Christmas movies.
Okay. So, having said that, Die Hard's a Christmas movie. Right?
Not for the reasons you think.
No. Well, for the reasons I think. But you and I have had this conversation before.
I think we have.
So, it comes down. And you know what? And I know Bruce Willis has said that it's not. And I think Bruce Willis doesn't give a, like, my opinion, I don't think he really gives a fuck what your opinion is. I think he says it to be, you know, obnoxious and contradictory just because it's...
As long as the checks keep coming in.
Yeah. Well.
It's not a Christmas movie because it happens at Christmas. It's a Christmas movie because it's about a family obligation that descends into an unending nightmare.
Yes. Yes, like every Christmas. So what are other great examples of Christmas movies then? Like non-traditional, because, you know, when it comes down to it, Christmas Story's still one of the greatest.
Yeah. Christmas Story, National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation.
Yeah. Speaking of eggnog.
Yeah, speaking of eggnog. Okay. Refill your eggnog, drive out to the middle of nowhere and leave you for dead.
Yeah. I think, you know, then there's the other Christmas movie traditions where you're going to... watch Lord of the Rings or whatever is going to be on TBS and things like that, but...
Well, TBS is going to have a Christmas Story.
Yes.
For 24 hours.
For 24 hours. One day they're going to stop doing that, right?
No, probably not.
Yeah. We'll see. It'll be like 21:35.
So much easier than thinking up programming that no one's going to watch.
Yeah.
Than not thinking about programming that no one's going to watch.
So, a buddy of mine from the Wayback Club, he and I actually, we're going to try and make a Michael Moore style mockumentary around Christmas. Did I ever tell you about this?
No.
Fahrenheit Ho Ho Ho.
Jesus. No, you have not told me about Fahrenheit
Ho
Ho Ho.
Yeah, the whole thing was about how Santa Claus was actually Jesus's little brother. And he was really, really irritated because his brother got all the attention during Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
And so he's like, you know what? I'm sick of this. I'm stealing his birthday. I'm just going to take it. And so...
Thanks, capitalism.
The development of Christmas as a holiday was basically Santa saying, F you, brother. And, you know, so there's this all these different conspiracy theories about it that, that you kind of bring up during the movie. At one point, you're interviewing an elf, but it's like with the backlight and they're all shadowed, so you can't see their face.
Their voice sounds really weird and disguised.
And they're talking about how, like, no, this image, this happy-go-lucky image of the North Pole where everybody happily builds toys all year. He's like, no, it's a slave shop. It is a sweatshop. It is a prison camp for elves. And, you know, we try and get out of there, and he escaped, and now he's building shoes in Iowa or something like that, you know, just trying to hide and not be caught.
So,
and by day two of the interview, he disappears. You know,
this sounds like it could be an instant holiday classic.
Oh, I think it'd be great. Sipping my blended eggnog.
The most unholiday movie ever.
Yeah. You know, and it's like completely in the Michael Moore, that we're going to exaggerate every part of this conspiracy theory.
Like Spinal Tap. Yeah. This is Santa Claus.
Yeah, exactly.
Nice.
So we didn't make it. Maybe one day we will. We'll see what happens. Then I have to go look him up.
And yeah, he's got to own rights to that or something.
Yeah. Yeah, it might not be worth making it. Our friendship didn't end great. So.
Oh, that sounds awesome.
Yeah. We became business partners. Don't ever do that. Oh, wait. You and I are business partners. Son of a bitch.
Don't become business partners with jerks.
Yeah.
Actually, I have heard that story, though. Yeah.
To not become business partners with friends?
I think you and I were driving to the bank to sign papers on our business, and you were telling me about your last business with a friend.
Yeah.
To bring all that up.
We really want to do this? Yeah, sure. What could go wrong? 2020.
Hey, at least we didn't open a restaurant.
Oh, yeah, that was close.
Dodged that bullet.
Not that it won't happen, maybe one day, but doesn't need to happen soon. Anyway, hey, you want to take a quick, break, have some fun, and then we'll come back and do some more fun?
Do some more fun?
You know, you sent to me all these awesome, hilarious Christmas songs. I think we should play one.
Let's do it.
Awesome.
We could do an awesome holiday Christmas song review.
Okay, we'll be right back.
Chipmunks roasting on an open fire. Hot sauce dripping from their toes. Yuletide squirrels, fresh filleted by the choir. They poked hot skewers through their nose. Everybody knows some pepper and a garlic clove help to make them seasoned right. Tiny rats with a crisp golden coat will really hit the spot tonight. And now when Santa sees his train, there'll be some homemade chipmunk jerky for his sleigh.
Hey, look at that.
And every hungry child is gonna spy. And so I'm brushing on some honey glaze.
It just gets more and more inappropriate the more you listen to it.
To keep them crisp and juicy too. Let's hope they get served many times, many ways. Tasty chipmunks, good food.
On that, Mr. Cole?
Yes, sir, Mr. Sevilla.
Would you mind handing me the barbecue sauce? I am starved.
Oh, no problem, Dave. Hey, listen, you best be having two of them drumsticks because they're oh so tiny and ain't much meat upon them.
What about animal rights, Dave?
Put a sock in it, Melvin. You know, for years people said you overrated hamsters were my meal ticket. Now I guess you could just say, you're my meal.
That's a good one, Dave. How was you was the funny one in the group?
Damn straight.
And so I'm offering
Melvin
some recipes. From chipmunk pie to chipmunk stew. I'm not really sad that it ended this way, furry chipmunks. Screw you.
Did you hear that, Melvin? Melvin? Melvin!
Well, I'm sorry, Dave. Did you want Melvin? There's plenty of Thagador left, though.
That's just brilliant.
Yeah, so all of these are from Bob Rivers. So he's got a number of comedy Christmas albums out. This is off of the classic Chipmunks Roasting on an Open Fire. Not to be confused with I Am Santa Claus, Twisted Christmas, or White Trash Christmas.
Can we get him on the show next year?
I don't know. I don't know what Bob's doing now.
We should look into it. We only have 11 months to do it.
We'll make it happen.
You heard it here first. And we'll delete this episode if you hold us to it. Probably not. We'll just probably say too bad. Suck it up, Snowflake.
It'll end up on the bowels of Buzzsprout, never to be seen again.
Yeah. Should we do another one?
Yeah, what else you got over there?
What do you kids think? Should we do another one?
Big AC/DC fan?
Yeah, it's actually one of the first songs I learned how to play guitar all the way through was Back in Black.
Really?
Yeah. So, yes. And because of that, it's like on my wish list. I can't afford it right now, but there's an amplifier I want. It's a Fender Twin Reverb, mm-hmm. which is like the classic amp. And it's so awesome. It's got two little twin speakers on it. It's mm-hmm. just like a little practice amp, but the sound on it is so iconic and so... just that 70s, 80s rock that tours would go through, and they'd have stacks and stacks and stacks of speakers all over the stage, but all the sound would be coming from that little amp with a microphone on it because the sound coming out of it was just perfect for that genre of music.
Is that tubes?
Yeah.
Nice.
Now, you can still get them, you know, because they're such collector's items. People will, like, drive them into the ground and then sell them, and people come in, put new tubes in them and over there. But... even like a good like late 60s Fender Twin mm-hmm. used is still like $1,600 to $2,000.
Wow.
For a little practice amp.
Well, it's keeping the tube industry alive.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, such a badass sound. But for AC/DC, I showed you earlier, this is, they had, played Jim Brewer. I don't know if any of you guys listen to much Jim Brewer.
From Saturday Night Live?
Yeah. Goat Boy. One of the funniest live stand-ups I've
Goat
ever...
Goat Boy.
Yeah. You remember that?
Yeah, I remember Goat Boy, yeah.
So I we'd actually gone and saw him live once, and you know, he's doing his bit, and people are kind of heckling him. He's just going, dude, Goat Boy! And he just really, you could tell. He's like, oh, God.
It's that one thing that I did at that one show.
Yeah.
Damn it.
And then he just, and every once in a while, he'd just be talking to me. and he would do it, and people would just kind of back down a little bit. But he did a stand-up special on Comedy Central with a band, mm-hmm. and he did this bit on AC/DC where... You know, he starts talking about it. It's like it always comes in with this guitar, and it's
always got the band playing the instruments in the background.
Yeah, and you know, he comes in and he's like, you know, they could sing anything, and it's Brian Johnson comes out and he's dancing around, does that thing, and hokey pokey.
Oh, they can turn anything into a metal song that rocks and everyone loves it.
Yeah, but it's
and he used the hokey pokey as an example.
The way Brewer does it is perfect though, because it's the perfect AC/DC live concert experience. The way he talks about it, because he's like, yeah, he'll go out there and he'll mumble a bunch of stuff you have no idea, and then he'll be like, all right, and it was like, all right. All right. it's like the best, but because he nails the band, and it's just so check it out.
Metaphorically, not physically. Yeah.
Yeah. Metaphorically.
Totally different live show.
Yeah. So it's one of the best. I love Jim Brewer. He's really really funny, and actually, what was really really great about his live stand up. Is that he would do impressions of his other cast members.
Oh, from SNL?
Yeah. So, you know, he did a really good Will Ferrell, mm-hmm. where he stuck, because like when he was doing Anchorman, he stayed in that character when he wasn't on stage. When he wasn't in another character, Will would stay in that Anchorman character the whole time. And finally, he's like, he told this story. And I was like, oh, yeah, screw this. I'm going to give him a break. And he goes in and just starts wailing on him and punching him. And then he's just like the whole time they're fighting and wrestling and throwing him on the ground. He's like, well, this is highly irregular, you know. But and then he does a what's his name?
Sounds like
Tracy Morgan.
OK,
he does an impression of Tracy Morgan where. I guess apparently on purpose, Tracy Morgan would always get Will Ferrell's name wrong and it would call him Will Ferrell. And just, it's hilarious. So if anybody gets an opportunity to see Brewer live,
it. And that was just his, Comedy Central special.
No, the one I'm talking about now, the AC/DC was on the comedy special. Mm. The other stuff where he was talking about his time on SNL was live.
I wonder if that's on Netflix.
It might be. It's, you know, it's worth looking at, but check him out, because he's way way more funny than just Goat Boy. Goat Boy was a great character, but
yeah,
dude's just hilarious.
There's a lot of really underrated stand-ups out there.
Yeah.
What's your favorite stand-up show you've been to?
That I've been to?
Been to, yeah.
Brewer might be up there. I would say, oh, what's the one that we did in Montreal?
Oh, Trevor Noah.
Trevor Noah. That one was amazing, because he went in and all of a sudden he's like, he plays to his audience so well. Mm-hmm. And, you know, because he goes in and he's making fun of the whole French-Canadian thing and being able to speak the language and do the dialects.
He localized his special. You know, if it was a 45-minute set, he took a 30-minute set and he had 15 minutes of local content that he wrote that weekend when he flew in.
Yeah. So he live, Noah was great.
I was not prepared for Noah to be that good. Like I'm a Daily Show fan.
Yeah.
You know, I always enjoy him there, and I'm like, oh, he does stand up too. We'll see. He was really good. Well,
and you watch that.
Really good.
You see him live and you're like, that's why I got the gig.
Yeah.
Cause he's so smart about world politics and he's just very worldly. You know, he's been a lot of places. His whole bit he did about living in Ireland, mm-hmm. Just, you know, in the accents there and talking about, you know, anywhere in Britain going and getting Indian food.
And, yeah. Well, and it just, and again, you know, the tools of the stand-up, the setup and the delivery,
yeah,
the follow-through and the callback, he nailed all of it.
He does. He's so good, such a professional. So he was good. I always really like Kevin Smith. An evening with Kevin Smith.
Yeah,
and it's not so much stand-up. It's just he's such a good storyteller.
Yeah, his is more conversational, and yes, him telling stories about jobs he's done and you know, other people in the industry that he's interacted with. Yeah, those are great.
Yeah, it makes in situations like that, it he comes across as so approachable,
mm-hmm.
and he could be a buddy,
mm-hmm.
you know, and it's like Kevin Smith could be a buddy. Like I totally like, yeah, that guy could be a buddy. We, you know, cause you know, with his comic books and everything else and his nerddom, he could come in and sit in on the show and right off the bat, the three of us had great banter. He's just that kind of guy. I really feel like it. The same thing, like Trey Parker, Matt Stone, I would love to be friends with those dudes. And something tells me, like, I don't even think they're close friends anymore. I think that they do their thing, but I think that they had a falling apart.
Was this post Book of Mormon, I'm assuming?
Yeah, I think so. It might just have been a bit. I feel like I saw something, an interview with Matt Stone or whatever, where he was being asked questions and he was just like, yeah, you know, we don't really talk that much anymore outside of work. But it might have just been a shtick they were doing because they're always doing shticks.
Yeah. So Trevor Noah's up there.
Yeah.
Jim Brewer.
What about you? I mean, of course, I know you're going to say it. We've said this before. All time, Carlin.
Carlin
is the best of all time.
And I got to see him in Milwaukee,
yeah,
which was an amazing show.
Never seen him live.
Great live show. One of the funniest stand up things I've ever been to was Brian Regan.
Yeah,
I saw him at a little hole in the wall comedy club. The kind of and he's a stand up where you see him sell out, you know, stadiums and large crowds and, you know, mm-hmm. you know, big comedy festivals and all that. When they play a small strip mall comedy club, just tiny room, and they shake everyone's hands as you walk out of the place. Oh, that's amazing. I saw Patton Oswalt.
Oh yeah. That would be good.
Downtown Orlando at the Social.
Really?
That little bar in between, was it Beecham and in Ibar? Right there. Yeah. Him and Brian Posehn, actually. There's a whole tour that came through, and it's a bar. That's not even a comedy room. That's a bar. That was a great show.
You know, that reminds me, Frank Caliendo. I saw him live at UCF and met him afterwards. He was terrific. But he's always like, I remember when I first got turned on to Caliendo, I was listening to Sirius satellite radio.
Yeah.
That I had gotten a little thing for your car. And I thought, you know, just how fast he talks and how fast he changes characters. I thought it was an ensemble bit.
Really?
Because, you know, it's like there's no way that one guy is bouncing back and forth. Because nobody's ever done anything like that other than, again, another one of the greats ever, Robin Williams.
Yeah.
To be able to jump back and forth. But I don't know, his ability just really sound like he's almost interviewing himself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, especially with the John Madden stuff. And
his Madden was so good.
Yeah. No,
it's got to be one of the best Madden impressions I've...
Yeah, so he's really terrific.
How long ago was that?
A decade or more ago. It was probably 2009, 2010, somewhere in there.
Holy shit, 2010 was a decade ago.
Yeah.
The hell did that happen?
Yeah. Sandy pointed out about a week ago. It'd be about a week ago. She pointed out one morning, she gave me a kiss and said, happy 29th anniversary since our first kiss.
Hmm?
Our first kiss, December 20th, 1991, in her mom's driveway.
Wow.
In high school.
Wow.
That's crazy.
91. Holy crap.
Yeah. 29 years. Whew.
You're old.
I'm old. I might be able to take you though. So back on the Duke. Well, on that note, I think that we should say some thank yous and some Merry Christmases.
Yeah.
And might as well Happy New Year, because by the time you're listening to this, it's 2021.
We could just throw out some thank yous, some belated Merry Christmases, and a Happy 2021 as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So, start with our favorite, Dave Martin.
DemoDavePro.com.
We love that guy. We're going to get him on soon to participate in more of our conversations. Thank you to Rum Council and all of our friends for our Wednesday weekly meet. They're great supporters of us and the things that we do. So thanks to the Rum Council.
And if you're going to drink on a Zoom call, make it a rum.
Yes. Although you've been drinking a lot of wine on that.
Yeah, admittedly, I have a lot more wine lying around than rum.
What, you don't have a shelf like my show?
Also, the Zoom calls tend to go like 6 hours long, so sometime around 2 a.m, it's like, oh, good.
I've had a lot of rum.
Yeah, all right, somebody from New Zealand is chiming in.
He's Southern Australia. Mm. He does have a house in New Zealand, though.
He's from New Zealand.
Yeah. He's got a house with a Corvette in it.
I thought he sold the vet.
Oh, he might have. That's right. That sounds right. Anyway, we're dragging on. Thanks for participating. Thanks for listening. Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, Kwanzaa, Festivus, and all that other stuff. I don't even remember whether other things get celebrated. Hanukkah.
Whatever you celebrate, stay nerdy, my friends.
Yes, bye.
Later that same evening.
Wait, you still recording?
Oh, shit. Hold on. What do we hit?
That's your program.
Damn it. Hold on. Shit.
What do you usually hit?
Let me try this.